All right, if I could have your attention again, I know many of you are still enjoying your meals, and I encourage you to continue to do so, but for the sake of staying on schedule, we're going to proceed with our program, and we have such a robust online audience for these programs as well. We want to make sure they're able to tune in a timely manner. To introduce our featured speaker, it is my pleasure to introduce another colleague to you, Adam Oakes. Adam currently serves as a development officer here at the Reagan Ranch for Young Americas Foundation. Adam grew up in a conservative family in Northern California. Yes, there is a conservative family in Northern California. After looking for an organization that would further his values, he discovered Young Americas Foundation and first got involved as a student attending our high school conferences just like this one. And like many students who attend these programs, he was inspired to go back to his own school in Pleasanton and start a YAF chapter. After completing high school, he went on to attend Liberty University. He discovered Liberty through Young Americas Foundation. And while attending Liberty, he served as chairman of the LU YAF chapter for 2.5 years. Adam helped orchestrate numerous events, such as, again, the 9/11 Never Forget Project, Freedom Week, and was instrumental in bringing in key conservatives to his campus, Dinesh D'Souza, Steve Forbes, Judge Jeanine Pirro, and Star Parker. During his tenure as YAF chairman, the club hosted the largest and most successful events, student events, on the Liberty campus, which says a lot for a school like Liberty. Adam interned for Young Americas Foundation during his senior year of college back at our national headquarters office, and after graduating, he began work full-time for the foundation as a development officer. Here at the ranch, Adam holds the rank of Eagle Scout from Troop 911 in Pleasanton and is one of the few people who makes me feel short. Please welcome Adam Oakes.
Thank you, Andrew. I think Ron said it best earlier. I think he said we were trying to start a basketball team out here, so that's one of the reasons why I was brought on. But I'd first like to start out today by thanking all of our virtual past attendees participating around the world. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, but not attending via virtual pass, head over to yaf.org/virtualpass and log in now and submit your questions for the speaker. By using the form on the right side of your screen, you can ask the speaker questions that he will answer after the lecture. We'll choose the top 2 to 3 questions, so make sure they're good ones. Today, I have the honor to introduce Congressman Tom McClintock from California's 4th District. Mr. McClintock, often described as the gold standard for fiscal conservatism in Congress, was born in White Plains, New York, and graduated from UCLA in 1978. Mr. McClintock is a previous member of the House Budget Committee and has proposed major fiscal reforms to curb unauthorized appropriations, control mandatory spending, balance the budget, and protect the nation's credit. He is a senior member of the House Natural Resources Committee, where he serves on the Subcommittee on Water, Oceans, and Wildlife, which he chaired from 2011 to 2015. And on Subcommittee National Parks, Forest, and Public Lands, which he chaired from 2015 to 2018. The Congressman is a member of the House Judiciary Committee, where he serves on the Subcommittee on Immigration and Citizenship, and also serves on the Subcommittee on Crime, Terrorism, and Homeland Security. Prior to his election to Congress, Mr. McClintock served 22 years in the California legislature when he became one of its most recognized conservative leaders. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Tom McClintock.
Well, folks, thank you very much. Thank you for an invitation to return to give another speech at the Young Americas Foundation. I'm very rarely invited back a second time for reasons that I'm sure will become apparent as my speech progresses. But I am reminded of that story of George Bernard Shaw and Winston Churchill. I guess you'd call them frenemies. And one day Churchill received a note from George Bernard Shaw. "Dear Winston, enclosed are 2 tickets to the opening night of my new play. Bring a friend, if you have one." Churchill quickly wired back, "Dear GBS, cannot attend opening night. We'll be there on the second night, if there is one." So thank you for having me back for a second night. And I have to tell you, as a California Republican congressman, it's a lonely life. And I appreciate any invitation to get out of the House. You realize there are only seven of us left on the entire planet. We don't breed well in captivity. Our critical habitat has shrunken to just a few inland pockets of reason in California, and we are being hunted to extinction. So at least those of you here today will be able to tell your children that you actually saw one once. But that, of course, isn't good enough. Yeah, I remember the last time we were in the minority, Phil Graham told us, he said, "Someday, when you're holding your grandchild in your lap, it's not going to be enough to say, yeah, Grandpa was in Congress when the country went to hell, but I voted against it every step of the way." And that's why the Young Americas Foundation is so important to the future of our country. We simply cannot lose this fight for our country's future. Because, as Daniel Webster is said to have observed, miracles do not cluster. And what has happened once in 6,000 years may not happen again. So those of you who are here today to support the Young Americas Foundation are doing the most important thing that we can possibly do as Americans to safeguard our future. And those of you who are here today to participate in the ongoing programs here at the Reagan Ranch, you are training to carry these ideas into what may well be the most serious challenge they have ever faced. You know, the American founders worried a lot about a generation that might lose the memory of freedom someday. Ronald Reagan often reminded us that freedom isn't in our DNA. It has to be passed down from generation to generation, and that it is always only one generation away from extinction. And when I see the sudden popularity of an utterly discredited and corrupt form of despotism called socialism, I worry that perhaps we've reached that point in time and our efforts must be focused more than ever on relearning and reteaching the founding principles of our country. The good news is the Young Americas Foundation, and the other good news is the American founders didn't call them self-evident truths for nothing. Now, being the sole survivor from the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee's 2018 California target list, I'm the only one they didn't get on that list. You know, I've often asked in millennialese, WTF, which I'm told roughly translates into, well, what's happening in California? Well, the answer is a lot has happened, but I'm concerned that there are two recent developments that may have pushed us past a tipping point. One is the rigging of election laws by the Democrats in Sacramento. The Democrats have always had a significant part of their constituency that can be described as dependent and disengaged. They could never get them to register. They could never get them to vote. Now, to register, you had to go before a deputy registrar of voters. They were easy to find. They were always on duty in libraries and firehouses and city and county buildings. But you had to declare yourself. You had to swear to your eligibility. Registration closed 30 days before the election so that all parties could canvass the precincts and challenge invalid registrations. And then, after the entire debate was over, after we had heard from the candidates on both sides, only then, on that magical day, election day, did we go to a polling place, usually in a neighbor's garage, looked our neighbors in the eye, received our ballots, and then went into a curtained booth to secretly cast those ballots. George Will called this the communion of democracy. But over the last 20 years, the Democrats changed all that in California. Registration was first made available by postcard and now automatic upon receiving a driver's license. Same-day registration was instituted, so anyone could walk into a polling place on election day, show no identification, and demand a ballot. And instead of casting your ballot at your local polling place in secrecy, you are sent a ballot and can hand it to anyone who comes knocking at your door to collect them. Now, even assuming there's no fraud in this system, and they have certainly removed every safeguard that once protected the integrity of the ballot, this has allowed the Democrats to vote an otherwise disengaged constituency, and that, I think, adds about 5 points to their margins. Under the old system, and even without modern computers, we usually knew the outcome of even the closest races just hours after the polls closed. And yet last November, David Valadao was 6 points ahead of his Democratic rival the day after the election, only to lose day by day over the next several weeks as additional ballots were counted. The other development is, well, I think it's the inevitable result of any leftist government. The good news for California Republicans was we are still winning the vote. The bad news is people are now voting with their feet. The census tells us that California is suffering a sustained and steady net domestic out-migration of population. Last year, 138,000 more people moved out of California than moved in. Over the past decade, we have lost 1 million more people moving out than we have gained from moving in. 3 million more people have moved out than moved in since 1990. And the only reason that California's population is not collapsing is because of babies and foreign immigration, much of that illegal. And despite complaints from Texans who complain about Californians who come to Texas and bring all their bad political habits with them, according to polling done by the Texas Tribune, California expatriates who are moving to Texas are 2-to-1 conservative. 2-to-1. So think about that. That's a net loss of about 2 million conservatives from California since 1990. That's another 5% right there. And I have to tell you, that's my own personal experience as well. The two things I hear the most often in my district are, first, and I hear it every week, "Tom, we love you. We've lived here our whole lives. But this state has gone batshit crazy. And we just bought a home in Arizona, Texas, Colorado, Utah, Idaho, Florida, Tennessee, you name it, and we're out of here." And the other thing that I hear just as often every week is, "We just moved here from the Bay Area, and we are very disappointed with your votes." And what the census is also telling us is this mass migration of people out of California. A lot of them are finding a better future in the middle of the Nevada and Arizona deserts. Now, I want you to think about what a profound development this is in human history. California has the most equitable climate in the entire Western Hemisphere. We've got the most bountiful resources anywhere in the continental United States. We're poised on the Pacific Rim in a position to dominate world trade. And yet, hundreds of thousands, and over the years now, millions of Californians have found a better place to live and work and raise their families in the middle of the Nevada nuclear test range than they were able to find in California. Now, I submit to you that no conceivable act of God could possibly do that much damage to our beautiful state. Only acts of government can do that, and they have. And oddly, it's disproportionately the middle class that's leaving. A friend of mine makes a very good living these days advising California companies on relocating. He works out of Utah, by the way. His rule of thumb is, if you're making over $500,000 a year, hey, you can afford the nice weather. If you're making under $50,000 a year, no reason to leave. There's lots of free stuff, and your taxes are relatively low. But if you earn between $50,000 and $500,000, get out of Dodge while you can. And last month, a statewide poll discovered that 53% of Californians want to leave California. And here, the other thing that got me was 63% of California millennials want to leave California. Now, that's the same age cohort that we're told loves socialism, which I find is rather odd that so many people seem to love socialism but hate the conditions that socialism consistently produces. And that's our challenge. It's to connect them with reality. You know, as a Californian, I can take some consolation in knowing we're not alone. We're seeing the same population migrations occur out of the other left-wing states that the left has controlled for a decade or more, Illinois and New York being the most prominent of them. And really, should that surprise any of us? Socialism, turns out, doesn't work any better in California than everywhere else it's been tried. And when you see what you see in California today is all of the hallmarks of any leftist government. It's remarkably consistent. It's remarkably predictable. Wherever they seize control, within a decade or so, you face failing schools, rising crime, growing poverty, unaffordable housing, crumbling infrastructure, skyrocketing energy and water costs, sky-high taxes, fleeing businesses, and an exodus of the middle class. Look everywhere the left has controlled for a generation, and you see exactly the same things over and over. How is it that we're losing this discussion among young people? A generation of leftist government in California has turned what we once called the Golden State into the state with the highest effective poverty rate in the country. We once boasted the finest public school system in the country. Today, only 29% of California fourth graders in the state are proficient in math. Only 28 are proficient in reading. Each of those scores the third lowest share of any state in the country. California's strong sentencing laws in the 1980s and 90s brought our crime rates down dramatically. You remember when we threw out Rose Byrd and Jerry Brown's appointments to the Supreme Court, we enacted the three strikes law, and what happened? Crime went way down in California. Well, they've now replaced these laws with the sanctuary policies, measures releasing dangerous criminals back into California communities. By the way, guess what? California's violent crime rate is now going back up again. It's gone up now 4 years in a row. We now have the second highest gasoline tax in the nation, and yet we rank 46th in per capita highway spending. Is anybody really surprised we're spending so much time in gridlock traffic? Is it any wonder that California's freeways, which were once the finest in the world, are now consistently ranked among the worst highway systems in the country? Housing restrictions and regulations. You've seen right here in Santa Barbara, big time. They've constrained the housing supply in California by an estimated 3.5 million units over the past 15 years. In other words, we have built 3.5 million fewer units than the population requires. That's forced housing prices to be among the highest in the nation. In 1974, Ronald Reagan's last year as president, the price of a home in California, adjusted into modern dollars, was about $176,000. The same home today, median price is $544,000 in the same inflation-adjusted dollars. So inflation-adjusted dollars, the price of housing in this state has quadrupled. We have the fourth highest per capita homeless rate in the nation, not a coincidence. A state with among the most abundant water resources in the nation has not built a major reservoir of over 1 million acre feet since 1979, while the population has nearly doubled. We now face the fiasco of year-round daily residential water rationing, set at 55 gallons per person per day, under legislation that's already been signed by Jerry Brown and simply awaiting to take effect. Green energy policies have forced California's electricity prices to the seventh highest in the nation and produced the nation's second highest gasoline prices behind only Hawaii. Now, this isn't the fault of taxpayers. None of it is the fault of taxpayers. Californians pay the highest income tax rate, the highest state sales tax rate, and the fourth highest corporate tax rate in the country. And not surprisingly, the major discussion in Sacramento is whether to impose a split-roll commercial property tax, a brand new tax on water, or a brand new tax on the internet. No doubt they will reach a compromise and agree to all three. Now, it has been observed that California, despite all of its problems, is still one of the best places in the world to build a successful small business. All it takes is to start with a successful large one. In fact, when I sat down with a group of business people from Lake Tahoe a decade ago, I asked them, well, what's it like to be doing business in a community that's divided between two states? And one of them quickly answered, oh, in Tahoe, it's very simple. On the Nevada side, they ask, how can we help you? And on the California side, they ask, how can we stop you? And it shouldn't surprise any of us that the lion's share of all of the commercial activity in Tahoe is on the Nevada side. And that also shouldn't surprise us. It's nothing new. De Tocqueville observed this very phenomenon when he sailed down the Ohio River in the 1830s. He pointed out that the Ohio River divides the very fertile Ohio River Valley. It separates the free state of Ohio on the north bank from the slave state of Kentucky on the south. And he said, we sail between liberty and servitude, and a transient inspection of surrounding objects will convince us which of the two is more favorable to humanity. And then he pointed out, on the Ohio side, where there was freedom, he said there was activity everywhere you went, thriving commerce, abundant harvests, and prosperous workers. On the Kentucky side, he saw only poverty, inactivity, and misery. Well, slavery and socialism have always been two sides of that same coin. As Lincoln said, it's the same spirit that says, you work and toil and make bread, and I will eat it. He said, no matter what shape it comes, whether from the mouth of a king who seeks to bestride the people of his nation and live by the fruit of their labor, or from one race of men as an apology for enslaving another race, it is the same tyrannical principle. Now, capitalism, which is just another way of saying freedom, produces prosperity for all that engage in it. Now, socialism's been sold to a new generation as the cooperative, caring, charitable form of governance and capitalism. Freedom is derided as greedy and selfish and corrupt. Well, we need to start reminding people it's exactly the opposite. There is only one possible way to succeed in a capitalist system. You have to help other people. You have to figure out the needs of other people and fulfill those needs, and you succeed only to the exact extent that you are helping your neighbor with goods and services that they need and want. Socialism is exactly the opposite. It's the taking of what one person has earned by meeting the needs of his neighbors and distributing those earnings to those who have not. It shouldn't surprise us that those who do the redistributing redistribute much of it to themselves. Socialism, by whatever name they choose, democratic socialism, European socialism, social justice, however they try to disguise themselves, all comes down to a belief that society should be forcibly directed and structured by a benevolent, all-powerful government. Capitalism comes down to the belief that the choices we make in our lives should belong to us as individuals. They should be voluntary and protected and respected. And lest we ever forget, every society that has fallen for this siren song of a benevolent and all-powerful government has always awakened one morning to discover that the benevolence is gone and that the all-powerful government is still there. We're seeing the end of all of that in Venezuela. We're seeing the beginning of all of that in California, and the rest of the country needs to benefit from the example. And that's our greatest challenge, to restore an appreciation and reverence for the principles of freedom that are enshrined in the American founding, and that centuries of experience have proven to produce the happiest, most productive, most cooperative, and the most peaceful societies in the history of human civilization. When two forms of government have been tried throughout many, many centuries, and one consistently produces prosperity, justice, and happiness, and the other just as consistently produces poverty, corruption, and misery, It stuns me that this question should ever be in contention today. But it is, and the fact of the matter is, it always is. Lincoln, in that same speech, reminded us that it's an eternal struggle between these two principles, right and wrong, throughout the world. He said, and I think prophetically, that is the real question. That is the question that will continue in this country when these poor tongues of Judge Douglas and myself shall be silent. And that brings us back to this place, this moment, and this organization, the Young Americas Foundation. The left controls virtually all of the major influencers of public opinion today. They control most of the press, academia, entertainment. The only thing we have left is the self-evident truths of freedom. But as long as the groups like the Young Americas Foundation continue to proclaim these self-evident truths, I believe there is great hope for the future. To me, the most important thing we can do is to assure that the same ruinous leftist policies that are already destroying California and Illinois and New York, and for that matter, Venezuela and most of Europe, don't go any farther throughout the rest of the country. That's why I ran for Congress after 22 years in the state legislature. I had watched these policies slowly corrupt and erode the golden state of opportunity that my parents had found. I'll be damned if I want to see that happen to our country. We can't let it happen. And after all, we can always move to another state. But where do we go if we lose our country? The Green New Deal is just the latest iteration of Jerry Brown's old era of limits, when he canceled the highways and dams in mid-construction, stopped the new electricity generation, began the 45-year process of strangling the two mainstays of the economy, agriculture and manufacturing, to death. The California laws that have done so much damage to the integrity of our elections are all included in the components of H.R. 1. H.R. 1 is so numbered because the Democrats consider that to be their most important bill of the congressional session. They voted it out of the House last week with all the intention of suppressing free speech, expropriating taxpayer funds for their own campaigns, and rigging every election across the country as they have in California. My colleague, Congressman Doug LaMalfa, calls it the Californication of our national elections. Well, when you consider these laws and all the others like them, proposed or passed by this new House majority, you can see how close we are as a nation to the precipice. We can look to California to see where all this is heading and how a single election, the next election, could tip the country over the edge. History is screaming warnings at us. Nations that either cannot or will not defend their borders simply aren't around very long. Nations that bankrupt themselves aren't around very long. But most of all, free nations that lose the memory of freedom aren't around very long. Let me offer one more thought. I want you to think of all of the wondrous advancements that we've seen in our technology because of the freedom of capitalism over our lifetimes. I think it's rather interesting to note that innovation has almost always come forth from the capitalist societies because of the freedom that they offer to innovate and the rewards that they provide for those who achieve these great breakthroughs. Can you imagine, with all of the discoveries we've seen in our lifetimes, what awaits humanity 1,000 years from now? What would it be like to live with all of the wondrous things that have yet to be discovered over the next 1,000 years? Well, historians have noted that if the republican institutions of Rome had endured, we'd be living in those times right now. I mean, think about this, that the Romans already had invented the steam engine. They hadn't quite figured out how to put it to practical use yet, but they understood the steam engine and they were producing them. They understood the fundamentals of magnetism. They'd already developed a rudimentary wet cell battery. They had all the materials for the introduction of electricity. They had only to put them all together. They'd mastered hydraulic engineering and civil engineering. Imagine where we'd be today if the Industrial Revolution had begun in the 5th century instead of the 19th century. They were on the verge of just such a breakthrough when the political institutions collapsed around them, followed by 1,000 years of darkness. and they collapsed because of many of the same issues that we are confronting the American left on today. Ladies and gentlemen, this stuff matters. America matters. And the Young America's Foundation matters because the role you are fulfilling is to assure that there are thousands, tens of thousands of young disciples of freedom across the land that can take the good news that freedom proclaims and that it has always delivered prosperity, justice, happiness, and liberty for every man and woman of goodwill on this planet. So thank you for the work that you're doing. Thank you, young people, who are preparing yourselves through the YAF programs to carry the light of freedom and reason into the darkness that's descended on our college campuses. So let's go out there and save our country. And after we've done that, maybe we can even save California. Thank you all. And I'll be happy to dodge any questions you have.
Questions here. So we're going to start with some of our virtual pass questions. Students, if you have any questions, please form a line behind Alex and Hayden here. And then supporters, if you have a question, please raise your hand and I will bring the mic to you. So we'll start with a virtual pass question.
Thank you.
Now, for those of us who still live in the 20th century, what is that exactly?
So our first question is from one of the thousands of people participating in this event virtually from the, all over the country. So these are people who are tuned into the live stream that we have of this speech. And our first question comes from Leah Yang from Palo Alto, California. Her question is the president's proposed budget attainable with the border wall funding included? And if not, how do you suggest we fund the wall?
Well, first of all, the border wall funding is a tiny, tiny fraction of the overall budget. We're spending north of $4 trillion a year as the federal government. The border wall funding that he's requested in the budget is $8 billion, a tiny fraction of that. And by the way, also a tiny fraction of what illegal immigration costs American taxpayers every year, the net of which is estimated to be well over $100 billion every year. But that pales in comparison to the importance of simply securing our borders. If our immigration laws are not going to be enforced, our borders mean nothing. And if our borders mean nothing, we cease to be a country and simply become a vast international territory between Canada and Mexico, both of which, by the way, do have borders and do actually enforce their immigration laws. So I view that as one of the great mortal perils of our country. And again, we can point to other civilizations, including Rome, that was unable to ultimately maintain the integrity of its borders, and it collapsed. And that's the paradox of immigration. Every country protects its own principles and culture and political institutions and customs and traditions with borders. And because of the differences among all of the countries, some are very successful, others are not. That's what drives immigration patterns. The more successful is a country, the greater the incentive to immigrate to that country. But if you do not maintain your borders so that assimilation can occur, so that as people come to your country, they assimilate into your society, they adopt a common language, a common culture, and a common appreciation of our American political principles. If we fail to do that, then we lose the very principles, the very institutions, the very traditions and customs that have made this such an attractive place for the people of the world to move to. Ronald Reagan used to say something. He used to say, defense is not a budget issue. You pay whatever you need to pay to defend your country. And the price of the border wall is a very, very small price to pay against a very great threat to the continued success of the American Republic. That was my virtual answer.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Mason Strand from Canyon High School in New Braunfels, Texas. First off, sorry for stealing your people from Texas. They're great people. I actually have one in my YAF chapter.
I am told, though, that the most popular bumper sticker in Nevada these days is, "We don't care how you do it in California."
Well, there you go. Yes, we actually do not really like people from California. We're always like, why are you coming in so liberal? So most of them, as you pointed out, are conservative. My question here is, how do we push bipartisanship to get people to understand what capitalism and free enterprise is over socialism and dictatorships? Thank you.
I think the most obvious answer is, look at where these forms of government have been tried down through the centuries. None of this is new. Open up, you know, history is the lab notes of civilization. The more I'm in government, and I've been in it for a long time now, the more I'm convinced there's no such thing as a new idea. When somebody comes up with this bold new idea, it's really a good idea to look back in the history books and find out how that bold new idea produced over the last 10 times it's been tried. And again, there is never been a more consistent history of freedom and authoritarianism as we have compiled to this date. Free societies, those that are organized around capitalist principles, thrive and succeed. They are the most just, happy, and prosperous societies in the world and in the world's history. And those that practice the very forms of authoritarianism, and again, I think Lincoln was absolutely right. Freedom and socialism are simply the same thing stated differently. I have always produced misery, corruption, injustice, and poverty. And you can see that around the world today. The freer a society, the more prosperous it's like, and the more just it's likely to be.
We have a roundtable attendee here who has a question. Otherwise, we'll go to another virtual pass question. Oh, perfect.
I have to tell a story. This is Dottie Scott here. I've got to tell a story on Dottie. When I was 25 years old, I was first running. And by the way, you young people, don't worry about being young. That's actually an advantage. People, I think you're viewed upon as a bit of a curiosity, and people will listen to what you have to say. If you've got something important to say, they'll listen. But I was 25 years old, running against the incumbent mayor of Oxnard without a hope in the world. We did a fundraiser in Ventura. 9 people showed up, and Dottie and her husband were 2 of them. Anyway.
Well, I have a question, which I think is the simplest thing in the world, but why can't we do it? Get past a law that says English is the conversation of this country.
Well, we are a nation of immigrants, right? Every one of us, unless we're full-blooded American Indian going back on all sides throughout the generations, every one of us is an immigrant. We're either immigrants ourselves or we're the sons and daughters of immigrants. We've created this great nation from all of the people around the world. How do you do that? How do you create one great nation from all the nations of the world? You do it, as I said, through assimilation. That's why our immigration laws are written the way they are. They're not written to keep people out. They're written to assure that when people come to this country and are admitted to this country, they're coming here with a sincere desire to become Americans, to raise their children as Americans, and to set aside the traditions and principles of their own country and adopt those of ours. A common language is absolutely essential to assimilation, and without it, you cannot build a great nation from all the nations of the world. You end up with a balkanized, feuding society, and that is exactly what the left has been trying to do for well over 50 years, to separate us as Americans, to tell us and remind us and dwell on all the things that divide us rather than all the things that unite us. And one of the most fundamental is language. If we cannot talk to each other, we're no longer a nation. And they're trying to break all that down. I mean, look at our national motto, E Pluribus Unum, from many one, from many people one people, the American people. There are no, the only race in our country is the American race. And when we focused on all the things that united us, we were the strongest nation in the world. And what has the left done? They have done everything they can to break us down into warring, feuding factions. That's the identity politics from which they are drawing of their strength. And we've got to stop it because it's tearing this country apart. And by the way, and they know it, and that's why they're doing it. Yep.
So we have another question from a virtual pass attendee. This is from Jeffrey Scottsburg from Little Rock, Arizona. The question is, what is it like working with AOC and other radical leftists in the House? And what is anyone on the left actually willing to work with you to get things done?
You know, people ask me variations of that question. You know, why can't you all, you know, get along together and sing kumbaya? And Lincoln, in fact, I'll go back before that. There was a day, if you think things are partisan now, there was a day in 1856 when Congressman Preston Brooks crossed the Capitol Rotunda, entered the Senate chamber, took his walking stick, and shattered it over the head of Senator Charles Sumner of Maine. Almost killed Sumner. I mean, this was a near murder. Do you know how Brooks' constituents responded to this murderous act by their representative? They sent him new walking sticks to replace the one that he broke. 2 years after that is when Abraham Lincoln gave his famous House Divided speech. And if you remember, what he said in it was this. He said, a house divided cannot stand, and I do not believe that this nation can permanently endure half slave and half free. I do not expect the government to dissolve. I do not expect the house to fall. But I do expect that it must cease to be divided. He understood that those two principles that were both competing for the future of our country were completely incompatible. They could not coexist. Think things are bad now. You remember a vice president of the United States who, looking at the self-evident truths of the Declaration of Independence and the very foundation of our country, declared, this was a vice president, said that our country was founded on self-evident lies. You know who that president was? John C. Calhoun. Lincoln understood this. Lincoln understood that freedom and slavery were fundamentally incompatible. You couldn't ultimately compromise with them. You couldn't be half one and half the other. Ultimately, one or the other would succeed because they were simply antithetical concepts. How different is that today? We're facing exactly the same antithetical concepts, just under a new name. Instead of slavery, it's socialism. But as Lincoln said, it's founded on exactly the same principle. You work and toil and make bread, and I will eat it. That's what's going on. So that's why I think the controversies are so much more acute today than we've seen any time in our lifetime, because these two completely incompatible antithetical principles, freedom and socialism, are now in a final death struggle to determine which will dominate our country for generations to come. That's why this battle is so important. You cannot compromise these fundamental principles. We must become all one thing or all the other. We must either restore the American founding principles that produced this country and go on to another century of American prosperity and liberty and hope around the world, or we will simply become another failed socialist state. That is the raw basic argument that we are resolving today as Americans. And that's why you're seeing such intense division among the people of our nation.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone who's helped on behalf of all of my fellow students. Thank you guys all for helping us come here. We really appreciate it. So thank you. My name is Taylor Dean. I'm from Santa Cruz County. I go to the Scotts Valley Middle High School. My question is, there's been an increasing rate of homelessness, and we can attribute that usually to left-wing ideology and incentives that happen. How can we prevent that from extending? Because I know homelessness shouldn't actually, it's kind of punishable, because It's so, sort of loitering, and you can't live on the public street. Yet we allowed this to happen.
Well, what's particularly new is this notion of working homeless. People with full-time jobs are no longer able to afford homes and are out on the streets. And again, I think it comes back to a very simple point, and that is when a free market was able to meet all the demands of an expanding population, there was affordable housing at every income level. If you were working, you could afford a roof over your head. And that's what has changed so dramatically. We've added so many costly regulations under the price of new housing, and we have so greatly restricted the ability of people to build new housing that we've seen, as I said in my prepared remarks, the price of housing in California has literally quadrupled since 1974. My folks came out here in 1965 looking for new opportunity. And they found it here in California. This really was the golden state. Taxes were low, jobs were plentiful. They found the home of their dreams. It was a ranch-style home in Thousand Oaks, a swimming pool in the backyard. They bought that home for $35,000 back in 1965. Now, if you do the inflation adjustment, I think that comes to roughly $200,000, $225,000 in today's money. My mom, who's here today, still lives in that house, and 50 years of wear and tear later, the prices in that the homes in that neighborhood are selling for $800,000, $900,000. Which means, had they come here today to find a new future, to provide for their children, they wouldn't have been able to find it here in California. And that's true at every level of income, and that's why we have this new phenomenon in California, working homeless. And what do we do about it? Comes right back to the same answer over and over again. Freedom works, and it's time we put it back to work.
Thank you so much.
Okay, we have time for one more question here, and then the students are heading up to the ranch, so.
This is gonna be kind of a tough one, okay? Why can't Congress get over the Social Security problem? It seems to me like a very simple solution. In 1935, Roosevelt passed this law, and we've been paying into it over my 30-year career, about $450,000. I don't need it, okay? What can we do? I've thought about a situation with the OMB coming up with a heuristic number that would take the taxes out of it and turn the money back into Social Security and give me a tax credit for the rest of it. Why can't Congress come up with some of these simple ideas to get this solved? 55 million people get Social Security. If 10% did it, you could fully fund Social Security for anybody who needs it.
Well, essentially, they're just basically three knobs to turn on Social Security. You can either increase the tax burden, which has been increasing consistently over the years and is becoming a significant hindrance to economic expansion. You can reduce the benefits that we have promised to the entire generation that has spent their lives paying into that system, or we can gradually, as we did back in the 1980s, I believe, slowly increase the retirement age for those entering the workforce. Now, when Social Security was established, I believe the average life expectancy was about, well, I think it was 62, 63 years old in those days. You retired at 65, so if you were an average Social Security recipient, you'd been dead for 2 years before you qualified. Average life expectancy now is 78, 79 years old. And we did readjust that once before. We kept it, the promise to everyone who is at or near retirement, we didn't affect them. But to those who were just entering the workforce, who could adjust their retirement and financial plans throughout an entire lifetime of work, we gradually increased the retirement age, only by a couple of years, I think from 65 to 67. To me, that seems the most reasonable way to maintain the promise that we have made to the generations that have paid in, and yet assure that it will not collapse on the next generation. But I do have to say, if you feel badly, you should have a 1040 tax form at home. When you get to that bottom line, that's just a minimum suggestion. You are allowed to pay more if you like. I understand that, but I've always resisted the notion that we should break the promises to the people who have spent their lifetimes, not by their own voluntary decision, but by the mandate of law to pay into into Social Security, however much you make, however secure your retirement is. You made your investment decisions in part based upon the promise that the government made to you as it was taking that money out of your paycheck and out of your employer's bottom line year after year. Those plans that you made in part influenced by the promises that our government made to you. It needs to keep those promises.
When we asked the congressman to speak and give his analysis of the state of affairs in California, I suspected he would not be pulling out his Mr. Rogers sweater and feeding us cozy words that make us feel better about ourselves and the state, but sober words we needed to hear. And the congressman mentioned his mother is here with us and sister as well. Mrs. McClintock, we appreciate the role that you have played in raising such a fine, courageous, historically literate defender of freedom. So thank you all, and thank you, Congressman. We are grateful for each of you who've joined us here for the roundtable today. I would encourage you to keep a close eye for an announcement on next month's program. We're working on a unique program for a first-time visitor here to the Reagan Ranch Center. It will likely not follow our typical format, typical date and time that we hold these luncheons. So look out for a notice very soon announcing the details of that program for April. Our students are departing almost immediately for their visit to the Reagan Ranch. I would encourage you with a 45-minute drive up to the mountaintop ahead of you to make a quick stop in the restrooms and then make your way out front to board our shuttles. If you are able to hang out for a few minutes, the rest of you to allow our students to get ahead of you, that would be helpful. But if you need to leave immediately, please feel free to go greet our valets. Thank you again for being with us. We look forward to seeing you soon.